As people are taking their seats, I just wanted to give a shout out to some of our wonderful helpers today. Amelia Beto is our data manager, our climate map maker par excellence, and programmer, and the rock bed of this whole event, who spent hours and hours from going to Costco to pick up the refreshments to keeping us all organized. So a big shout out to Amelia for doing such a great job. And as many of you know, we have this event every year. It's different every year because, thank goodness, we're making progress in our research every year, so we have new information to share. So please come and join us every year. And we will be posting the wonderful picture that Samantha, our kid care coordinator's sister, a shout out to her. Thank you so much for being the guest photographer today and volunteering your time. And we'll put that photograph with permission up on our website so people can see it with credits to our wonderful photographer. And other helpers who have made this event possible, including Beth Avon, our KD parent, and the AD coordinator and communications expert. So we're gonna switch to a slightly different set of topics this afternoon, later this morning. And our first speaker is Jen Burney, who's a professor here at UCSD in the Department of Global Policy and Strategy, which I wouldn't immediately know that makes her a climate scientist, but that's what Jen is. And like all of our team working on the climate science hypothesis of Kawasaki disease, this is Professor Burney's Nights and Weekends project. So I just want you to know that there's a big volunteer army doing this project. It is currently unfunded. We have no federal or other funding specifically for this project. And the need is obviously there to get more funding for the various elements of this. A portion of it is being funded by the Macklin Foundation, who we credited earlier, and we're super, super grateful to that organization for supporting the work that is part of the climate project. But we are going to be trying to look for more substantial funding to keep this going. So next two talks are going to be about our climate science objectives and the progress that we're making. I just want to preface all of this by making sure that people understand that we're not telling you that we found the cause of Kawasaki disease yet, but we want you to come away with the sense that we may be on a path that's going to lead us there in the hopefully near future. A lot of people have told me they can't either retire or die until we figure this out, so we're in for the long haul. So without further ado, Professor Burney.
Thanks, everyone. It's really an honor to be here. I was trying to explain to the KD clinical team how unique this is for a climate scientist to really have an event that's linking patients all the way through to sort of the hypotheses that we're testing in the world, and it's really special to be part of this. So, So Dr. Burns asked me to talk today to give you all a little bit of an overview about where we are, where we stand on the climate and environmental science side when we think about Kawasaki disease. And so what I'd like to do is present work today from the climate team, and I want to do my best to set up the next presentation by Will and Jared. And I just want to make it clear that I'm going to present work that's been done by a lot of people in the class that I'll show you today. In particular, were done by Dan Payne, Hillary Banco, and Martin Rendell and myself. So a big group, we're sort of the weird cousins in the Kawasaki disease research family. We're kind of like oddball climate people, but we are so happy to be part of this family. So the thing that's really important for me to start by saying is that I don't know anything about medicine at all. And as my kids would say, I'm not a real doctor. And this is part of why this has been so part of why I love being part of this group. I'm learning so much. I've learned, you know, so much in the past hour and a half even. So who am I now? I'm an environmental scientist. And lest you think, oh, environmental scientist, she might know something about biology. Like, no. I'm a physicist. I'm a physical scientist, and I study the connections between our climate and food systems. So thinking about people and patients and learning genetics that I haven't thought about since high school has been really, really exciting. And I got connected to this group because I've worked on agricultural emissions, which is something we think might be interesting, and Will and Jared are going to maybe touch on this a little bit later. And I've also done a lot of work. My core research group is focused on the way pollutants behave in our climate system. So I really love this interdisciplinary work, and I'm hopefully going to try to draw out what's special about this research like in an interdisciplinary way in the next few minutes. And finally, you know, maybe most relevant right now is I'm a parent, and I've spent a few scary days with a kid admitted at Brady Children's Hospital, and I'm well aware of what a special place it is. It wasn't for counseling, but you know, it is a really, really special community, and I'm delighted to be linked in, not just as the parent of the patient. So, but I really have a strong sort of emotional pull to the group this year today. All right, so when we think about, a disease model that involves the environment, right, there's some things that we're looking for, and there's some stuff that we already know, and you guys are all well aware of this. Kawasaki has a pretty regular seasonal pattern. It changes depending on where you are. So over on the left of this slide, you can see some figures for San Diego, for Seattle, and for Japan. And while the total number of cases varies a lot, there is a pattern. Maybe one thing you can take from this plot is why a conference is happening in September, which is sort of getting into the low point when maybe the Katie team could actually get away for like to have a conference. We have a sort of regular pattern here, as is the case elsewhere. And this has been something that's been known for a while, and there have been some big papers, and I'm sure you all are sort of aware of this research that links the seasonal cycle of KD in San Diego and elsewhere to the strength of winds blowing from Asia using some models. And linked big epidemics in the past in Japan, so three really big epidemics, with associated winds from North China. So this is kind of a provocative base from which we start our environmental research, right? But the amazing thing I would say is that the KD team here has such a rich set of data, and I say data well aware that each one of those data points is maybe you or your child, right? And you contributed to this amazing wealth of knowledge that we have here, and we can really learn a lot more. As an environmental scientist looking at this, you can say, let's take these data and let's try to put them into sort of a general model of what this might look like. And so, we start. And like the KD team really starts with illness, right? Who gets sick? How do they get sick? What does it look like? Not all KD looks the same. I'm going to talk about that more. Where are they and when do they get sick? And all these details that are sort of embedded in the history of the KD team's work here offer us some clues. But really, from an environmental science perspective or a climate perspective, that's the last step in the chain. This is sort of step four if we want to think about exposure. And we would work backward and say, okay, so really, what's happening locally? Is there anything, any environmental conditions that's associated with any of these patterns on the ground? And if we move back a step further, all right, maybe there's some local stuff that's happening, but is there any sort of large-scale climate pattern that might be associated with what's happening, or patterns? And I put these as dotted lines because maybe they vary in time, maybe there's multiple things going on. And then if we could get back to understanding some of the conditions that seem to be associated with KD, we might be able to think about where we could look for something like a causative agent. And that agent could be, again, sort of emitted or making its way into the environment in a number of different ways. And we don't really know that much about it. So this is for the next talk. But we would like to, from a climate perspective, think about all these different steps in the chain. And what we've learned from the KD team here in San Diego at Rady is that there is a lot of fine structure to KD incidents. Everybody's really well aware of the seasonal cycles, but what I want to talk to you about is there's all this other structure to how this disease occurs. So we're just looking at the who, when, where, and how, what the what is. We see that cases cluster in time. And I mean this much more fine scale than just the seasonal cycles. I'll show you this. So So sometimes there's kind of a trickle of KD cases, and other times lots of kids are getting them at the same time, right? Those cases also tend to cluster geographically, and that's a big clue that there's an environmental association. These cases cluster in clinical presentation, so you'll probably recognize some of these things from your own experience with Kawasaki disease, but not all patients come to have classic KD. Some get some of these weird other presentations like the big lymph node or high IgGT or peeling fingers. Some you can get any combination or none of them. But we think that might offer us some insight. And then James' lab and others have been learning about the genetic activity associated with different KD patients, and there's kind of clustering in what's happening internally as well, like what genes are sort of being whizzed and turned on or what are kind of being suppressed, and that's not homogenous across patients, and it seems to kind of clump together. Again, I sort of gave you that caveat earlier that I know nothing about biology, so what I am going to say is that we do know that the clinical presentation variation and the genetic activity presentation are not fully explained by underlying genetic susceptibility. So this is not fully explained by, say, race and age or other characteristics like that. So there's some variation in here that really looks like there's an association with the environment. So let me tell you a little bit about what we learned. All right, so this higher scale temporal clustering, this came from this insight from the clinical team, and it felt like the clinic was insane for little chunks of time, and then kind of quiet for chunks of time. And they were like, are we just sleep deprived? Is that like, is this like a real thing statistically, or do we just kind of feel like it's crazy sometimes? And it turns out, so here's a graph over time, from 2002 to 2017, partway through, of all the cases, every day, and these dots tell you whether there's one case, two cases, three cases, whatever. And if we think about what cases would look like kind of randomly distributed in time, what we see is that if we define like a cluster as a certain number of cases and a certain number of days, and a certain number of time windows, we see that these clusters happen way more than they would if this was just sort of a constant flow or if there was sort of a random scattering of cases. So it's a really very important statistical signal here. There is like anomalously weird temporal clustering. And this is, you know, this doesn't really, it's not too sensitive to how you define this, but we're going to use this idea of a cluster, a time cluster, as more than 4 cases in 7 days, 4 or more cases in 7 days. And these happen way more than you would expect to patients. The other thing is that, so here's a map of where the big cases in our greater catchment area are. A little zoom in on the San Diego and North County areas. If you look at all these pairs of cases, one thing that stands out is that cases that occur within a week of each other, so again, think about the 7-day period, so cases that are within a week of each other are much more likely than chance to be located near each other spatially. Now, not at a distance that would suggest some sort of contagious mechanism, right? So we're not going there. But at a distance, a spatial scale of, you know, 20, 30 kilometers, they're more likely to be that close to each other. That suggests really, again, kind of an environmental interaction. So these are all kind of these smoking guns just from the way that data and the case load has occurred over time in the space. That we have started to think that we have some hooks into what this means. So, on the kind of environmental side of this, our conclusion is that we really need to look at both local and global scales to kind of understand what's happening here. So, how do we know, as climate scientists, think about whether climate is related to Kawasaki disease? So, what we do, knowing is understanding kind of where this research is going and how it's happening, actually, right? So, we generate what we call climatology. And this is an average condition for every location at every day of the year. So you can think about it as like, you know, the average January, average February, et cetera, but you know, a fine scale over the course of the year. The average condition at any day in any location. And we did this for the whole study period. So right now, we're gonna use cases between 2002 and spring of this year. And we're gonna look at all these variables that we think might be important. So what's going on with temperature, what's going on with precipitation at the local level, and then more generally at the global scale, what's happening to sort of global circulation? What does it look like on average? What do pressures look like and what does wind look like? And then for different sets of cases, so for example, you can imagine a subset of Kawasaki cases, for example, children over 10 years old. That's just a hypothetical group. But we could take all those days in which those cases occurred, taking the date of onset, and we would look at how those the climate conditions on those days, on average, differed or did not differ from the climatology, the average conditions for those days. So, and we also look sort of before and after sea trends. And we see if these sets of cases are sort of statistically different from average days. That is, how anomalous or bizarre they are. And we call these climate anomalies. So I'm going to show you some plots. And the takeaway here is that if a map looks white, it means nothing interesting is happening. That the subset of cases I'm showing you just look like average days. And if you see color and some and cross-hatching and you know, excitement in the plot, that tells you something interesting is going on. So I'm going to show you a little bit. I'm going to start with some maps locally of the Southern California area, and then we'll get to some global stuff. So my first conclusion, something that we have seen now, where it's pretty robust, where, you know, days without Kawasaki disease are just average days. So I'm going to show you plots from this whole time period. This is what the maximum temperature looks like, what the minimum temperature looks like, and what precipitation looks like in Southern California on these days. And this is the deviation to these anomalies. How much different are these days from just average days? What you can see is that it's 0, 0, and 0. These are just nothing interesting, climatologically, is happening on days where there's no Kawasaki disease. Right? There's no anomaly in climate speak, or you know, maybe in our lab group speak is kind of boring. Right? Nothing interesting going on. But now, we can look at all case days. So these are now going to take all the days in the main Kawasaki season year, so sort of between December and April. We're going to take those cases over all those years, and we're going to look at now how different are those days from normal days at that time of year. And what we see is now something starts to show up. We have sort of warmer nighttime temperatures associated with KD, and maybe a little bit of precipitation. But again, you know, these are statistically interesting, but we know that there's more information on the ground. So what we've done now is say, let's look at these temporal clusters. Let's look at cases that fall into those clusters and cases that don't. And again, I'm going to show you some of the same stuff. On the left is not in a cluster, and on the right is in a cluster. So days that are sort of KD is happening, but it's not in one of these high concentration events. Right, kind of look average on temperature, maybe there's rain up north, right? But days when you get these clusters, these bursts of lots of kids, relatively speaking, getting sick, are hotter. They're hotter during the day, they're hotter at night, and they're drier than average. So summary, there is now a really statistically significant difference between days when you get cases in clusters, kind of this concentrated event, and from the trickle of cases. So in an environmental exposure model, we want to know, okay, these are local conditions. What about transport? And you tell me. So here's global circulation. These are sort of, again, I think the takeaway of this plot is these are pressure anomalies. This tells you something about the circulation of winds. This is a white map. There's nothing interesting happening. And these are days when there are KD cases that are not in clusters. And these are days when there are KD cases in clusters. This is very strong versus in the robust. There's a strong pressure, high pressure anomaly, and that is consistent with winds traveling across the Pacific, sort of towards us from the Western Pacific. So this is what was hypothesized before the seasonal connection, and now this is at a much finer scale. So when we get these bursts in the clinic, there does seem to be an association. So we associate these temporal clusters with my time is up, I've got to show you one last picture. We associate these temporal clusters with larger scale patterns. What I'll say is that, you know, there's a lot of heterogeneity also associated with clinical presentation. So these days, when you get a certain type of symptom versus when you don't, they look very different locally. Very, very different locally. So we can talk more about that. Come next year. but all this to say is that we're getting an amazing amount of information from the patient histories and the care that the team that we've taken. And we're sort of honing in on an environmental exposure model. So we're cranking through these data. We're trying to parse apart everything that means, and it's really pointed to some interesting questions about what might be blowing over in the wind. And with that, I'll hand it over to Will Jarrett. Thanks.
I'm going to thank Jen for an amazing presentation. Audrey and I were actually seeing many of those data for the first time today, put together like that, so that was awesome. And now I'm going to introduce our the other part of our climate team. This is the junior representation of the climate team. And Jared and Will have been working with me, working on the hypothesis for the last couple of years. This is, again, a nights and weekends project for these guys. They're not going to be paid. And they are high school students here in San Diego, and it has been a pleasure and a privilege to work with them. And they're going to talk to you about the research that they're doing under the supervision of Professor Mark Themans, who unfortunately couldn't be here today. He's a visiting professor at UC Berkeley, where he's giving a number of keynote lectures today. So could not join us, but Will and Jared are here to represent his part, their part of the climate science investigation of Calisthenics. So take it away, guys.
So hi, everyone. Dr. Burns said, I'm Will Shiloh, this is Jared Bain. Today we're going to be talking about Kawasaki disease and how it relates to aerosols stemming from the northeast region of China in Harbin.
So just to give a brief introduction on Kawasaki disease, first of all, it's a serious worldwide health problem. The disease affects mainly children, and right now it's near epidemic levels in Japan. So the causes of the disease are unknown, but right now it's believed to be an airborne disease. And an important clue we need to keep in thought is that Kawasaki's disease did not exist before World War II. And through our analysis of the aerosols collected in northeast China, directly correlations with the biological particles in the pollutants may be present.
So one current theory about what is causing it, in the theory of our community to be correct, is that Kawasaki disease is either transported or is itself an aerosolized particle that is capable of traveling long distances in the troposphere, which is the part of the atmosphere 6 to 20 kilometers above the surface of the Earth. And people believe that these aerosols are stemming from northeast China, and the wind patterns that come to this region blow across Japan, across the Pacific Ocean, and end up on the west coast of the United States. And these regions are two huge epicenters for Kawasaki disease. So, what we've also been using as a couple of clues is potassium is a sign of biomass burning specifically. So if we see potassium in our sample, we know that there's some type of biological burning going on. And if we see sulfur, then we know that there's burning of fossil fuels. So this graphic just shows what we're talking about. You see circled right here is the Harbin region of northeast China. That's where the burning is going. You can see there's a large amount of particulate in the air. And these winds come across Japan, across the Pacific, and then land right here in Southern California. So that's what we're looking at.
So our process, we're studying the filters from Harbin in northeast China, and what we're doing is we're using the scanning electron microscope, which is at UCSD. We're capturing images and then also taking an elemental analysis of the particles.
So this graphic kind of reiterates what Dr. Bernie was talking about, the seasonality of Kawasaki disease. You can see really clearly the high case incidence is right here, and low case incidence right here. You see during the fall, you really don't have a lot of Kawasaki disease, all blue. And then as you move into the winter, you start to see a lot of cases, really spikes. And the spring is kind of like medium time, it's in the middle. And the summer, you see another huge spike. So that's another clue going on. So there are two main ways that these aerosols are being emitted into the troposphere. The first is through coal burning or fossil fuel burning. And this is mostly a result of public heating. In northeast China, it's really cold during the late fall and into the early spring. So October to April, there's a lot of fossil fuel burning going on because people need to heat their homes. But the second type of burning, the more interesting correlated burning we've seen, is biomass burning done by farmers. They, after the harvest, they burn their fields and get rid of the plant residue. So this occurs mostly in the late fall and early winter, as well as the spring and early summer. And if you remember the high cases incidence in the winter and the summer, this kind of burning is really easy to correlate. So this graphic shows kind of the pollution side. side of things, the you see the fall relatively clean, but as you go into the winter, it's a lot more dirty, more polluted, and the spring is kind of a medium between the two. So this kind of correlation with the instance of KD, the high in the winter, medium in the spring, low in the fall is directly correlated with the instance of Kawasaki disease. So the sampling process, how we actually get these filters, we have an HVAS, a high volume air sampler, mounted on the top of a building in Harbin, Northeast China. And what this is basically a vacuum that sucks air in. There's two sets of filters. The first filter picks up coarse particles, what we call them. It's 10 to 0.95 microns in size, and the air continues through another filter, which picks up particles that are less than 0.95 microns. So with this method, we're basically able to see all the types of particles that people would be able to, or potential patients would be inhaling in their lungs. And we've got like the all day, nighttime, daytime samples, so they're all pretty evenly distributed and able to all three.
So now we're going to our research. So I'm going to talk about the fall. So this is a sample from October 24, 2016. And the main idea we got from this sample is basically just a really clean filter. As you can see, those are fibers. There's nothing really over them. So it's really clean. The only thing we saw was mineral particulate, which is in the bottom left. And that's basically just dust. So then we took one from November 14, 2016 to just make sure that's consistent. We got the same idea. It was a really clean filter. A lot of mineral particulate. We didn't see any biological spheres in it. So as I said, some of the particulate in the filter, and then we didn't see many biologics, mostly just dirt. We also pay attention to sulfur and potassium, and there's a small amount. And then the cleaner air could relate to the smaller amount of KD, and there's a minimal amount of KD during the fall.
Yes, so moving to the winter, you can see the clear difference. You don't really see those fibers anymore. It's all covered with soot and dirt, and as well as some biological particles. These spheres, we determine biologics. And we thought this was interesting, seeing there was no biologics in the fall, and as you move to the winter, you start seeing biologics. You also see some crystalline matter, which we didn't see in the fall either. But as we move into January, you see even more biologics. You also see a lot of soot. It's still really dirty. And soot is a result of burning. So you see when there's a lot of burning going on, you see this really dirty filter. So our analysis in the winter, we saw lots of biologics. We also saw soot, which was rich with sulfur and potassium, so we knew there was burning going on. And the fact that this also is correlated to the peak season of KD is really interesting. And then moving to the spring, we saw the spring, as expected, is kind of a medium area. You see it's, you don't see biologics in April, but you do see some crystalline structures, these kind of plated smooth surfaces. We also see some more dust, mineral particulate, but no real biologics in April. But moving into May, we're going to see a resurgence of biological particles, which we thought was interesting considering that April and May is moving into the summer, summertime. So what we thought from this spring is that new amount of sulfur, new amount of potassium, because there's less biomass burning in the winter but more in the fall. And we saw more dirt, more mineral particulate, more crystals and soot during the period. And finally, from April to May, we saw no biologics moving into a time of a lot of biologics. So we thought that this kind of growth of biologics is likely related to the summer peak. So we decided to graphically plot out this, our findings. We used the SEM, the EDX mode. It basically takes an X-ray analysis of the sample, and it can tell you in counts per second the intensity of each element. So what you can see is sulfur seems to be clearly correlated with instance of KD. You see winter, the most like peak time of Kawasaki disease, is a huge spikes of sulfur. You see spring is kind of in the middle, and then fall is not nearly as much. And then potassium, it's still correlated. You see big winter, big spring, and then smaller fall, but we saw it's more correlated with biologics being present in the filter. There's biologics in the winter and also in the spring and on the fall, so that's really interesting. And keeping in mind that potassium is a sign of biomass burning, would expect there to be biological particles stemming from biomass burning, so this makes sense. This just shows that like not everything is correlated. You see calcium shouldn't be correlated, and you can see it's clearly all of those things are really not correlated. So our next step, and what we've already begun doing, we this past summer we traveled to China, and we were able to go to this volcanic glacier here. And this lake is special because there's no runoff, nothing's coming into it. The only sediment is settling on the bottom of this lake. It's coming from the atmosphere. So particles come down, land on the surface of the lake, and then ultimately settle at the bottom. So essentially what we're able to do is take these sediment cores, and as we go from the top down, are basically going back in time. You're seeing the composition of the atmosphere and how it changed over time. So we've been able to determine that approximately 1 millimeter is equivalent to 1 year. So our plan is to look approximately before World War II and after World War II, and as well as 1979, 1886, which are huge peak years. And we're going to be able to see what changed in the atmosphere, if there was a big change, if that could be correlated to the like existence of the arrivals of Kawasaki.
So our ongoing work, we're going to continue the studies with the filters. What we want to do is obtain and analyze the summer filter samples just to make sure that there's a presence of biologics in them. We also want to identify biological particles using DNA sequencing. We sent that to Columbia University. And then finally, we want to analyze sulfate and nitrate concentrations on filters and compare it to the pollution levels.
So as I just mentioned, we're going to use these, sediment cores. We're able to see composition of atmosphere during different time periods, and if that could be related to peak years or the emergence of Kawasaki disease.
So in summary, the environmental factors contribute to Kawasaki's disease. We've noticed that seasonal variations in the aerosols show biologic agents are correlated to the KD outbreaks. The burning elements, sulfur and potassium, we realize are correlated, and then dirt and crystalline matter don't seem to be correlated at all.
And basically what we've seen is that there's not really one thing that might be causing Kawasaki disease. It's not likely one biological thing, like just one potassium or sulfur. It's likely a combination of multiple factors, and that is consistent with what we found. That's consistent with the KD group's working hypothesis. So basically we know from this work that it's likely a combination of using sulfur, potassium, and biologics. So it's like a type of crystal. We really don't know yet, but we know that it's likely to be Kawasaki. And thank you for listening. That's all we have.
To be working with the Climate Science Group, with Jennifer and with Mark Venus, and to have Will and Jared who joined us for the last couple of years to be able to be kind of our next generation and next minds solving this disease for all of us. But we're not letting Dr. Burns retire until she does. So I have the pleasure of finishing up the morning for us. And what I'd like to talk about in the next few minutes is about new therapies. And I come up here every year and give a talk, and gratefully we've made some wonderful progress over the last year. We, of course, have already heard from Samantha Roberts and how we launched the Kid Care trial to be able to tell us which drug is better for IVIG resistance. And what I'm going to focus on are treatments for children with the coronary artery damage. For Kawasaki disease. For those who are genetically predisposed for having coronary artery damage, as I mentioned earlier, something that happens early, and we really need to be very aggressive in how we treat these children from the very beginning. So our hope is to be able to change the treatment paradigm for KD, to be able to diagnose these children, identify them, and be able to find new treatments for them that will really help stop coronary artery damage from developing. So another quick picture of the coronary artery that you've already seen there. And what I want to introduce is the concept of a Z-score. So why Z-scores? So we all know that children are not little adults, and we all know that children grow over time. So how do we compare a heart ultrasound and the size of a coronary artery in a child when they're 6 months old, and then when they come back at the year visit, so they're now 18 months old, and then I bring them back 5 years later, and 5 years until they turn 18. So how do I compare all those echoes over time? And this is where the concept of z-score comes in. So the mathematical definition is standard deviation from the mean, which gets normalized for the body surface area, so a combination of height and weight that take place. And so if a cardiologist, I'm Pete's idea, I'm not a cardiologist, so I need to understand what's happening with my child's echo, my patient's echo over time. The cardiologist just gives me the size of the coronary artery. That doesn't give me everything I need, because a certain millimeter size in a baby could be very abnormal and could be normal in an 18-year-old or a 15-year-old. So this concept of Z-scores allows us to understand, to give us the quality of the severity. And so we have used this and have been trying to tell everybody this is the way to go, not just with an absolute measurement. And I'll refer to Z-scores as we go through, because we use that to identify which of our patients are actually eligible for our studies. So as we all know, the standard treatment for Kawasaki disease is IVIG and aspirin. It doesn't work in everyone. We have IVIG-resistant patients, and we have those with coronary artery aneurysms, despite receiving IVIG and despite being brought to a medical attention early. So we need options. But unfortunately, the current management of coronary artery involvement in KD is really just following the echoes over time. And so what's been our kind of status quo in the past has been, you come in, you have an abnormal echo, we give you your IVIG, we go, oh no, you have an abnormal echo, and we get better echo. Oh no, your echo's still abnormal. So what we're trying to do is to change that so that we can act upon this very early and stop that inflammatory process that's happening at the level of the coronary arteries and really fundamentally stop the progression of aneurysms. That's ultimately what we would like to do. So here's a familiar drug to many of us in the medicine cabinets of most Americans, and this is Lipitor or atorvastatin. We've talked about the statins a little bit earlier, but I'm going to speak to you in a specific context. This is for children with acute Kawasaki disease. They just got admitted to the hospital. They just had their first ultrasound, and we've diagnosed a child with either a dilated, swollen, or aneurysm like ballooning coronary artery. And so years ago, you know, this drug has been used for years in adults, and it works very well, but it works well even when it's not lowering cholesterol. We all know this is a cholesterol-lowering agent. We are not interested in lowering the cholesterol of our Kawasaki disease patients. In fact, cholesterol is very key to brain development, and we don't want to do that. So why would we bother to use this drug in our KD patients? And that's because the statins do much more than just lower cholesterol. They're anti-inflammatory, they're antioxidant, which a lot of us have now heard about. It's kind of the brand name for eat something because it's antioxidant. And it happens to prevent vessel damage and promote vessel healing. So when you stop and think for a moment about these effects, you say, well, that's exactly what we want to do in acute Kawasaki disease. We want to stop inflammation. We know that the body creates a lot of free radicals of oxygens, we want to have an antioxidant effect. And we know that there's damage occurring at the level of the coronary arteries, especially if we're already seeing it by echo. So we wanted to capitalize on these effects. But we came to realize that the statins are actually only approved down to age 8 in the United States for high cholesterol, and in Europe down to age 6. So one of the things that we were faced with was the fact that this drug, this class of drugs, had never been standardly, like had never been systematically studied in children as young as we would like to treat. So we requested from the FDA permission to use it down to as young as they would allow us, and they let us down to age 2. And in the next few months, and hopefully what we'll have for you by next year is a little bit more information about using it even in children less than 2 years of age. But the data that I will share with you today is about kids down to age 2, which has never been done in any disease. Okay, so there's no data for children this young using statins, but this is a class of drugs that I think is very useful and is actually widely used in that age group without being studied. So every heart transplant patient actually goes on a statin, but it's not systematically studied even in young children. So I have really good news to share with you guys today. All right, and that is that we have finished our atorvastatin trial. 4 years.
Thank you.
To all of you that are here in person and also joining us by Facebook, many of whom have actually been part of this study to one degree or another, either donated a blood sample that led to initial work that caused us to actually want to study this drug, or even had a child diagnosed with early coronary artery damage and enrolled and entrusted us and your child to our care. So here's what I want to share with you, which is fantastic. The American Heart Association does an annual symposium, which is going to happen just right up the road in Anaheim in November. We have submitted an abstract, which is that first thing there, so we're going to be actually presenting an abstract as a poster about the safety and the pharmacology of patients with acute Kawasaki disease that have been treated with statins. And we also made a really big plug, and it doesn't happen every year. So we were granted a scientific session, so an hour and a half block of time at the American Heart Association, which is going to be dedicated just to Kawasaki disease. And it's our chance to have a national, international stage at this meeting to be able to discuss Kawasaki disease, not only the statin study, but a lot of the other work that you've been hearing about today. And so we're excited about this opportunity. This is a very great meeting to present our data. But even more importantly than having this stage is actually the data itself, and I'm going to share that with you today. And those are the results from our statin trial. So safety first. My job when I took my hippocratic oath as a physician was first do no harm. So I was of the scientific belief and rationale this would be something that would be helpful for our patients, but it's my duty as a clinical trialist to first make sure that I'm not injuring anyone. So we evaluate safety very closely in our patients that were treated with the atorvastatin over the 6 weeks that they were in the study. And these kids come into the hospital, get an echo that's abnormal. If they have a Z-score that's at least a Z of 2.5, so more than 2.5 standard deviations from the mean, they become study eligible if they're at least 2 years old, and they go on the drug for 6 weeks. What we determined is that in the 32 patients that we enrolled in this study, that we really didn't have any major safety issues. All right, KD patients, like all patients in a study, are going to have their ups and downs, but there was no major adverse issues that became a big red flag for us. Really importantly, I mentioned that cholesterol is key to brain development. Clearly, a two-year-old's brain is still developing. Even through young adulthood, we know that. So we do not want to be lowering cholesterol. We don't want any issues with brain cholesterol in particular. And it turns out that there's a way to actually measure in the blood brain cholesterol. There's a specific protein that gets sent out by the brain, and you can measure that in the blood. And through some extensive work done in our lab, we were able to show that there is no bad effect from being on a statin for 6 weeks to your brain cholesterol levels. This was really key. This is the first time that anyone's shown this. Again, as I mentioned, a lot of kids get treated with statins for a number of reasons besides the lowering cholesterol, but no one's really looked at this systematically. So we have thus proven the safety in at least down to age two. We've also looked at the pharmacology of this drug. And so the pharmacology of a drug behaves differently in children than it can in adults. So maybe kids need more, maybe they need less of a drug. Maybe they metabolize it differently and their body handles it differently. And so we've been studying all of that, and it turns out that the levels of atorvastatin, just by giving a particular dose, are higher in kids than they are in adults. And so we may be actually seeing more of an effect. The good thing is that we're seeing more drug levels, but we're actually not seeing more risk with the drug. So this is very important to understand the pharmacology in these young children to really be able to provide the proper drug dose to all of these children. So we've also had some fascinating interactions and collaborations, specifically with John Shee's group here on campus, to look at the vascular biology. So as I mentioned, this class of drugs promotes vessel healing, okay? And so we wanted to look at specifically that question. And what you have here is on your left what a normal vessel should look like of the coronary arteries. Because there's a lot of things that float inside the blood, but they shouldn't be crossing across the vessel wall. And what you're seeing here on your right-hand side is what happens in Kawasaki disease and all those bad things getting across into the vessel wall. What's important is that through the work that we've done in collaboration with John Shi, we've been able to demonstrate that this process is blocked by atorvastatin. And we've demonstrated that in the lab just by actually putting atorvastatin on the cells. We've also done that by collecting blood from patients in our study who are actually being given the drug and seeing that there's a different response of the cells when they're exposed to Kawasaki sera or the blood from patients that had statins and those that did not. So we've been able to demonstrate at a biological level what is occurring, which supports what we thought was happening, but it's very nice to actually see that actually occurring. So that's the statin study. Now what I mentioned was the limitation that we can only go down to age 2, but this is data that Dr. Burns showed before as well, a little bit different in terms of the actual numbers because the patients enrolled were a little bit different, but it's the same concept, which is that if you're less than 6 months old, you have a lot more pink, yellow, and red, so you have a lot more bad heart disease than if you are older than 6 months old. Now, we are not allowed by the FDA yet, and that's the caveat I will add, to use atorvastatin in children less than 2. We'll be going to back to the FDA with all the wonderful safety data that we have been requesting in the coming months to actually use statins in children less than 2 years of age. But that said, we are still left with patients currently that Dr. Burns and I see that are very young, especially those less than 6 months of age, that have severe coronary artery damage, and we need to do something to help those children. So that's where we're using a different concept and a different medication here. So I want to introduce you to the innate immune system, and these are all the first responders for all of us whenever we're exposed to either an infection or something that causes inflammation like Kawasaki disease. And our goal, understanding the innate immune response that happens in Kawasaki disease, is to block this process. So the rationale here comes from some work that's been done in a mouse model, actually, that where they can induce a disease that at the level of the coronary arteries looks like Kawasaki disease. Now these mice don't get rash, fever, and red eyes, but they do get coronary artery damage. And it turns out that if you have one of these mice and you can induce this, then you get that red arrow, you see a lot of inflammation, a lot of little black dots going on. But then if you block what's called the IL-1 pathway, which is a pathway involved in innate immunity, you see that that vessel wall actually doesn't have all those little black spots and it looks a lot thinner. And so it turns out if you block IL-1, that you're actually able to block the inflammation that happens at the level of the arteries in this model. So we know that kids are not mice, but we decided and thought that this would be very important data and very instructive because it turns out that there's a drug that is used in the world, specifically with autoinflammatory diseases. There are a lot of inflammatory diseases. Dr. Sheets uses it in his rheumatology patients called anakinra. And that actually blocks the IL-1 pathway. And the way that it does that, and you see there on the left, you see anakinra. And it actually mimics, like it's IL-1 beta, and attaches and then blocks. So it doesn't allow the inflammatory process to happen. This is an injection, but it is approved by the FDA down to birth for really severe inflammatory diseases. So I just wanted to finish up by explaining where we're at with this particular study, because this study allows us to enroll children down to practically birth, so down to about 4 weeks of age. We have what's called the dose escalation, so we have been increasing the dose. You basically prove that it's safe at a low dose, and you go up to the next dose, and you go up from there. We're currently at the highest dose that we've designated for this study, which is 8 milligrams per kilo per day, and we've enrolled 10 kids so far. And again, the safety data is excellent so far. And we're working closely with Dr. Shi's group as well to be able to look at the vascular biology and to see if we're seeing the same those same benefits from anakinra as we have from atorvastatin. But these drugs work differently. So atorvastatin, as I mentioned, works with vessel healing, but it works through the anti-inflammatory effects. Anakinra attacks a different part of the immune system. So our thought was, can we use these together? And can we actually create a healthier heart outcome for our patients by using these drugs in combination. And that's exactly what we are going to be studying, and that's exactly what we're setting out to do. We submitted an NIH grant. We had a very good score, and we'll find out later this fall if we're funded to be able to do this work. So we will have a small pilot project that will do exactly that. Children with severe coronary artery disease, initially with Kawasaki disease, and we'll put them on both medications and see how they do. So the last thing I wanted to touch upon is what happens in parts of the world where they don't get IVIG and they may not be able to get anakinra, which is really expensive, or infliximab, which we talked about, which is also really expensive. And this is true in many parts of Asia, in fact, in parts of also Latin America. The Philippines, for example, that Dr. Burns has done quite an amount of work with, there are a lot of families there and in India that cannot afford to pay for the IVIG, and so their child is diagnosed with PKD but not treated. So if you're not treated with IVIG and you can't get it, what do you have as your options? So this sets us up for a different avenue that we're going down towards, which is a drug called methotrexate. It's been around for a very long time. It's an anti-inflammatory medication. We want to tip the balance, and we want to evaluate the safety of this drug and how this works, and is this something that can be an option for those places that cannot get IVIG or in our very refractory KD patients that we've tried on a lot of different medications and just don't seem to get better. So there is an adult study that's being done. The newest trend in adult cardiovascular disease for patients that have the adult heart attacks that Dr. Daniels spoke about with atherosclerosis. There's a big study going on now using methotrexate in adults. This is certainly not unprecedented to use this anti-inflammatory. And that study is underway, and we will have, we're establishing our own study when it relates to Kawasaki disease. Just a quick introduction to this drug with methotrexate and how this works. This bottom part here of the slide shows all the inflammatory process that happens in Kawasaki disease, and our goal is to be able to block this with methotrexate and to have that be one of the other drugs that we have in our armamentarium for this group of patients of ours. And we'll end by saying that we have a different study called Brepixabam. This is not for an anti-inflammatory, but these are for, this is a national pediatric study that's open for enrollment at UC San Diego to Brady Children's Hospital. And this is for a child or a patient that has giant aneurysms on systemic anticoagulant. So if your child is at least 2 years of age and has giant aneurysms and is receiving either injections from low molecular weight heparin or with warfarin, then you will be very acutely aware of the pros and cons of those medications. This is an oral therapy that's given that doesn't require monitoring like warfarin and Coumadin. So that trial is up and running. If you have a child that's eligible, please let us know. We would be happy to discuss the study further. If there's someone that's listening to us from outside of the San Diego area, we have had families come to us to be enrolled in the study from outside the San Diego area. So please contact us. We would be happy to let you know a little bit further and if your child's eligible. And so with that, I'll just end by saying that it definitely takes a village, that we're indebted to our patients and families for all that you do, for all that, you know, it's 2 a.m, your kid just got diagnosed, you've never met us before except for the phone, but yet you still consented to have your child enrolled in blood trial on them for our work. We really appreciate that. So thank you for your kindness and patience. Please go ahead and fill out those forms with questions, and we will now be able to answer some further questions for you guys. Thank you. Thank you.
Can we just start with the question from the last session? It has to do with the natural approach to basically boosting the immune system. We get this question all the time, that every rheumatological disease we treat, is there some way to boost the immune system to make the body be able to fight off immune-mediated diseases better? And basically, all sorts of natural remedies have been tried. None of them have really been proven to help. And the reason for this is that this probably relates to the complexity of the immune system, but you will be bombarded about things that help boost the immune system that are dietary. You know, most of those things are in our diets, and we have a good, healthy diet, and it's good to eat those foods, but whether or not they actually can prevent diseases or ameliorate diseases that already exist, we don't actually know. So it's not an area that gets a lot of research done, unfortunately, so it's still a big open question, but it's still smart, we think, to eat that healthy diet that our cardiologist talked about earlier.
There was a question specifically asking about the side effects of the statins and if we see those in children. So we monitored very closely for that during our study, and we continue to do so on anyone who's on atorvastatin that we care for. So one thing that I love about being a pediatrician and specifically someone who's invested in the proper dosing of drugs for children is that kids don't have nearly the number of side effects that adults do. So we have not seen a lot of muscle issues and muscle pain. The liver abnormalities that happen in adults, maybe because we're having our Saturday night cocktail as well as our Lipitor. We don't see that in our children, and we haven't seen any major side effects, frankly. There's been a couple kids here and there, but it hasn't been anything to the degree that we see in adults. There was a question about vaccines actually triggering Kawasaki disease, and we do not think that those are related. There is, of course, the unfortunate thing that happens, which is that when your kids are due to get most of their vaccines is when they're most likely to have Kawasaki disease. There's maybe an association in terms of the timing of those two things, but we do not believe with any of the data that we've collected over decades of this illness that they're at all related or that vaccines trigger KD. In terms of posting of the slides, and Beth, I'm just going to ask Renata, if I'm right, she's sick, yeah. So my understanding is that through Facebook, these will be posted, and that's where you can view the slides afterwards. And there's a question about weight gain after Kawasaki disease. So a lot of children actually lose weight during the acute illness. I mean, for many of you, it took about, you know, 3 to 7 days to come to medical attention for this illness. It's not unusual for kids to lose weight. They easily gain it back. As far as we know, there's no association with an increase in weight gain because of Kawasaki disease, but kids usually just eat you out of the house when they finally get better. For KD patients in the statin trial, is there a way to confirm if the artery vessel walls have been deep and protected as believed? Yeah, so this study that we did is what we call phase 1-2A, and what that does is establish safety, and we also look at some activity, so those studies that I was talking about in the vessel wall. The next thing that needs to happen, and that I will be pursuing funding for, is that what we call the big enchilada in clinical trials, which is really to do the efficacy study, and to be able to prove that children on statins with acute coronary artery damage do better than those that are not on statins. And so we're doing a lot of combination, trying to think about combination therapy because we're trying to figure out what's the best study to design for our patients. Statins will be a part of that, most likely. But in order to be able to determine safety, there's another larger study that needs to happen.
So the first question is about how we chose RV and why, and where is the region to collect samples in? And first, it's just because our collaborators in China chose this. It's the capital city of the region of Heilongjiang. It's the most northeastern province. So they chose that because it's easy to get to. You can get flights in and out. But it should be right, or it should be like good, because when we trace the winds back from the west coast and from Japan. They all stem from this region, Harbin's right in the center, so that should be accurate. And the second one is, these are data from Northeast China about KD occurrence, and there really isn't much data because China is comprised of a lot of regional hospitals. They don't really collaborate in between each other. They just kind of have their patients and another one will have their patients. They don't really talk. So there's no concrete data on like total numbers of patients. But while we were in China, we had like more than one person come up to us and say that in their hometown they had occurrence of Kawasaki disease. So we know that it's happening. There is cases in Northeast China, but we just don't know.
Questions here. So the first question was about whether there could possibly be a relationship between radiation remnants from the atomic bombs dropped on Japan, not directly, right, in terms of radiation poisoning, but rather whether this could be related to some sort of change in biologic particles, whether radiation might be indirectly contributing. I'd say that there's a sort of wide and much broader set of research trying to understand just sort of the nuclear, open nuclear testing and bomb dropping error and like long run impacts of that, but it's not consistent with a lot of the finer scale weather associations that we've been seeing. So, you know, in particular, to think about the seasonality of where KD is occurring maximally and minimally, winds would have to be shifting in directions that's not at all consistent with what we see. So I don't think so. But this question about sort of what are the long run and indirect impacts of radiation is just a more broad, interesting question. But we don't think there's any connection here. The second question is: do the weather data correlate to the symptoms of a KD patient? And I unfortunately talked myself out of time, but the answer is we do see some provocative stuff locally. So the conditions, for example, if we take all the cases when patients have presented with, you know, that giant lymph node burst, we call it kind of node burst KD. When those cases occur versus when cases occur that do not have that symptom, those days look very different. The same is true for like when you have healing fingertips versus days when you have cases but without peeling fingertips. And in general, also cases when you have any of these weird clinical signs, the node burst, the high GGT, or peeling fingertips, and when you just sort of have classic KD without any of those things look very different. So we're trying to parse those out now. And, you know, one of the things that's interesting to us and the hypothesis that we're pursuing is that, you know, larger scale transport, global scale stuff, could be driving a lot of the clustering temporally, but then you could have interactions with the local conditions that could be creating different conditions that create different sets of symptoms. So, I think we'll have to stay tuned. There was a follow-up on that about whether reoccurrence could be different depending on the weather seasons, and as I understand, we really don't have enough statistical power about recurring KDs. I'm sorry, but we don't have any leverage on the question.
So there was another question about behavioral disorders, whether they're correlated with KD, and thankfully they're not. And the question really would be asking whether or not KD affects the brain significantly and gives after effects behaviorally. So there's no evidence that there's behavioral disorders with KD.
Question about
Kawasaki
disease cardiac surgery in our KD patients. So this is a last resort, and it can be effective and can be important and can be life-saving in certain selected patients. There are now lots of catheter-based interventions that can be used for older children. Unfortunately, in the babies who tend to have the most severe manifestations of the heart disease, the vessels are simply too small to be amenable to either bypass surgery, a type of surgical procedure where you actually put in a blood vessel that goes around the diseased blood vessel and supplies the heart muscle. That doesn't work very well in babies, and the catheters are simply too big to be used in babies. So cardiac surgery or surgical interventions are not a very useful approach. And unfortunately, some of our patients have to simply undergo heart transplant. and sharing with you this morning. We actually had one of our KD patients get a new heart this morning, and he's at Rady Children's Hospital, and prayers go out to the family. So another question is research done with genetic links with other family members having similar but not exactly the same kinds of vascular inflammation. And we really don't have any inflammation. We don't have any information either about a relationship to other kinds of diseases in family members. So again, through the adult KD study, we hope we'll continue to learn more about our patients as they age up. But right now, we don't have any information about KD being linked to other sorts of vascular diseases in other family members. Just a couple more questions to finish up our morning. I did get asked by a number of families about our patient that Jane was referring to. So the mom, Gina O'Neill, has asked me to share with all of you that if you're interested in knowing a little bit more about Crescent's progress, to check out their Facebook page that she's been updating, and also the hashtag Crescent Strong. And specifically related to a couple of other questions that I was asked, there was a question about relationship between KD and heart murmurs. So heart murmurs can be just because you're hearing blood flow through the pipes, as I say, kind of like when you turn on your water and hear your faucet run at home. But there can also be anatomical issues that happen, and those are not related to Kawasaki disease. So the aneurysms in our Kawasaki patients tend to be silent. They're not related to heart murmurs. So there's a question also about recurrence of KD and cardiac damage. Just to be clear, is that there was a question about if there was a recurrence of Kawasaki disease and the childhood had coronary artery damage with both episodes, are they more likely to have an issue later on? And that depends on the severity of the coronary artery damage that was diagnosed. So some of our patients can have what we call transient dilation, which is if the artery gets a little bit swollen and then quickly goes back to a normal size, and other patients have much more severe disease. And this is actually all ties into that Z-score that I was talking about. So depending on how severe your artery damage is, that's really where we can have a prognosis for the long-term effects. One last question. The question was, is there a genetic test to determine which parent passed the gene to the child? So we're not into the blaming game here, okay? But it's important to understand that Kawasaki disease falls into the category of what we call complex genetic diseases. It's not like sickle cell disease or cystic fibrosis. These are genetic conditions where there's a mutation in a single gene, and if you inherit one or two doses of that mutation, you will get the disease. This is a much more complicated problem where there are a number of different pathways where genes exist in different forms, and these are probably inherited a little bit from both sides of the family and create a unique situation in the susceptible child. We know that it comes from both sides because of the way siblings tend not to be very often involved. So obviously we have families where just through the roll of the dice, two siblings occurred that shared this complex genetic pattern. But in general, this happens rarely, fortunately. And also the genetics of the predisposition being passed on to the next generation, we are seeing a disproportionate number of our KD patients having children who then are susceptible to Kawasaki disease and get it. But it's not at the level of they're directly passing something down that just comes from one person. So at the current, our current understanding level,
we think that the genetic contributions probably come to a certain extent from both sides of the parents. So no blaming here.
You've been a great audience, you've been attentive.
I hope you've learned something. We'll stick around for a little while, so please come up and chat with us if you have questions that we didn't get to or you weren't able to ask. Thank you for coming, and we hope we'll see you back again next year to hear all the amazing progress that this talented contributor is able to achieve. So thank you so much.